أخرج الإمام البخاري والإمام مسلم في صحيحيهما من رواية أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: إنما مثلي ومثل الأنبياء من قبلي كمثل رجل بنى بيتا فأحسنه وأجمله إلا موضع أو إلا موضع لبنة من زاوية، فجعل الناس يطوفون به ويعجبون له ويقولون: هلا وضعت هذه اللبنة؟ فأنا اللبنة وأنا خاتم النبيين. Imams al-Bukhari and Muslim, may Allah have mercy upon them, reported on the authority of Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, my similitude when compared to the prophets before me is like that of a man who structured a house, who built a house, and he perfected it and beautified it, except for a spot for one brick in one of its corners. So people started circling that structure, amazed with it, expressing their admiration, impressed by its perfection and beauty, and said, if only this one brick was to be placed in its place. Then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am this brick. I am the last and final of all prophets sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam established two facts and listed two of his virtues. Number one is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final prophet and messenger. So anyone claiming otherwise after his death sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is an utter liar. Number two is that his legislation mastered the perfection of all previous legislations by Allah Azza wa Jal and abrogated all previous legislations. Allah the Almighty honored Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with many virtues and merits and various distinct qualities. And he mastered his manners and moral character sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah said about him in the Quran, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And you, O Muhammad, are indeed upon a great moral character sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Azza wa Jal distinguished him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with these qualities and favored him over all humanity, including messengers and prophets. And this was listed in the Quran, or mentioned in the Quran, and stated by him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about himself. Now one might ask, how can someone praise himself? How can the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speak highly of his own self? Well, this is easy to understand when we know that Allah Azza wa Jal addressed him saying, Ya ayyuhan nabi, balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik. O Prophet, convey what was revealed down on you from your Lord. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has no say, has no control. It's a command from Allah the Almighty. Allah the Exalted commanded him to convey this to people. so that people know his rank, so that people know his lofty status with his Lord, so that people love him more and honor him more and respect him more, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But because he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was the most humble of all people, in many narrations, he would state this distinct quality of his. He would mention his merit, which was granted to him by Allah, but then say, "Wala fakhr," but I'm not showing off. I'm not bragging about this quality. I'm simply listing. I'm simply conveying. I'm simply stating what Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded me to state and convey. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was given by Allah Azza wa Jalla many distinct qualities. Some are related to the dunya, to this worldly life, and some that will be in the hereafter. As per the distinct qualities, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or some, because I cannot, time does not permit, it needs lectures upon lectures to enumerate the distinct qualities the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was granted by Allah Azza wa Jalla. But I'll just mention few here and there. With regards to the worldly distinct qualities, one of the most important is that whenever the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla is mentioned, the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is mentioned in one of the most important matters in the life of a Muslim. It is the first pillar in Islam. You cannot enter Islam without mentioning the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and testify to his messengerhood after testifying to the oneness of Allah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan rasul. It does not work out for you to enter Islam saying Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah and stop. You must testify to both. And you must fulfill the implications of both. Allah Azza wa Jal, in many situations, mandated that we say both names together, his and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's an obligation to say tashahud in salah. Tashahud is said in adhan. Tashahud is said in iqamah and other different situations where we have to say shahada or mention the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coupled with the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And this indeed reflects the very high rank Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam possesses with Allah the Almighty. Another quality which only one other prophet and messenger possesses and shares with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Khalilullah, the intimate friend of Allah Azza wa Jal. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, and this is reported by Imam Muslim, said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I was to take a Khalil, an intimate friend, meaning from humans, I would take Abu Bakr to be my Khalil. But your friend, talking about himself, but your friend, your companion, is the Khalil of Allah. Another quality which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enjoyed is that he is the source of security to this ummah, starting with his companions. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhu, and this is also reported by Muslim, said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, النجوم أمانة للسماء. Stars are the source of security to the heavens. So when the stars go away, talking about the hereafter, or this rather the signs of the hereafter, what the heavens or the skies are promised will befall them, meaning they will be cracked and so on, the signs of the advent of the hour. And I am the source of security for my companions. So when I go, my companions will face what they are promised. Talking about the fitan, the trials that will take place after his time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ashabi amanatun li ummati, and my companions are a source of security to my ummah, to my nation. So when my companions leave, my ummah will face what they were promised. Goodness and virtue will be outnumbered by evil. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the source of security in this life. And with his death, people faced what they faced. The last quality I would like to mention, which is pertaining to this worldly life, is that he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was sent to all humanity and to jinn. Whereas previous prophets and messengers were sent to certain people, to their own people. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, تبارك الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا. Blessed is he who sent down the criterion upon his slave, on his slave, so that he will be a warner to the worlds. As to the distinct qualities Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam possesses that are related to the hereafter, the first is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be the first for whom the gates of Jannah will be opened. Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi reported on the authority of Anas ibn Malik that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I will go to the gates of Jannah and knock. So the keeper of the gate will ask, who is it? And I will say, it is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The keeper will say, I was commanded not to respond to anyone except you. I was commanded not to open the gates for anyone before you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will be a witness whose testimony will be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jalla and honored in the hereafter. In the books of Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim, on the authority of Uqba ibn Amir radiyallahu anhu, said, one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and prayed the funeral prayer upon some of the people of Uhud. And then he ascended the minbar, the pulpit, and said, أَنَا فَرَطٌ لَكُمْ وَأَنَا شَهِيدٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. I will precede you and pave the way for you on the hereafter, and I will be witness on you. So his testimony, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal on his ummah. And their testimony, the Muslim ummah's testimony, will be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal on other nations. A third quality which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam possesses, as reported by Abu Hurairah, or narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, and reported by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be the first with his ummah to pass over as-sirat, the bridge over hell, pass into Jannah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us enjoy this bliss and pass sirat and be admitted into Jannah. Allahumma ameen. The last quality I would like to address, and with it I will conclude, is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the master of the descents of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. All the descendants of Adam, he is the master of them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he will be the first for whom the earth will split open, and he will be the first to intercede. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ana sayyidu waladi adama wala fakhar. I am the master of the descendants of Adam, but I'm not bragging. I'm not bragging about being the master of the descendants of Adam. أنا أول من تنشق عنه الأرض يوم القيامة. And I am the first for whom the earth will split open on the day of judgment. ولا فخر. And I am not bragging. وأنا أول شافع وأول شفيع. And I will be the first intercessor and the first whose intercession is accepted. ولا فخر. And I am not bragging about it. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am the master of the descendants of Adam on the day of judgment. Despite him knowing sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he is the master of the descendants of Adam, dunya and akhirah, in this life and the hereafter. But he said the difference is that in the hereafter, his mastery and supremacy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will become evident. No one can dispute and argue. It becomes clear to everyone. Whereas in dunya, some of the people rejected it. Some of the people disputed it, debated that, denied him this. But in the hereafter, no one can and no one will be able to. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد ما ذكرك الذاكرون وما غفل عن ذكرك الغافلون اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد استغفر الله وتوب إليه الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد الصادق الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن اهتدى بهديهم واقتفى أثرهم إلى يوم الدين أما بعد Allah Azza wa Jal says in the concluding verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّن رُسُلِهِ. We do not distinguish amongst any of the messengers of Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, as reported by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and narrated by Abu Huraira, لَا تُفَرِّقُوا بَيْنَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. Do not make distinction amongst the prophets. So now, how can we understand this in light of the narration just mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am the master of the descendants of Adam? We have to differentiate between two things. This verse, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّن رُسُلِهِ, as Ibn Kathir, may Allah have mercy on him, said, we are commanded to believe in them all equally. That they're all prophets and messengers from Allah Azza wa Jal. And that they were all sent by Allah Azza wa Jal. And that we respect them all. However, Allah Azza wa Jal did himself mention in the Quran that with regards to ranks, they differ. تِلْكَ الرُّسُلُ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Those messengers, we made some of them exceed others. مِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَلَّمَ اللَّهِ. Amongst them are those who spoke to Allah or to whom Allah spoke. وَرَفَعَ بَعْضَهُمْ دَرَجَاتٍ. And he raised some of them in ranks above others. So, the summary of this point is, number one, we as Muslims should believe in all prophets and messengers. We should love them all, respect them all, believe that they're all prophets and messengers sent to people by Allah Azza wa Jal. Number two, we should believe, as per the verse, that they differ. They're not all at the same rank. Musa alayhi salatu wassalam spoke to Allah. This is a rank that's above other prophets and messengers who did not. Number three, we also believe that the best of the best is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is one of the five ulul azmi min ar-rusul. Ibrahim, Nuh, Musa, Isa, and Muhammad. And he is the master of all humanity. He is the master of all the descendants of Adam from the time of creation until the hereafter. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We should believe that the revelations that came down upon him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam overruled all previous revelations. His legislations revealed to him by Allah abrogated all the previous legislations. Now, someone with these qualities sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, someone who was sent to rescue me and you, does he not deserve to be loved? Does he not deserve to be obeyed? Does he not deserve to be imitated? Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, النبي أولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم. The Prophet is worthier of the believers than their own selves. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Imam al-Shawkani, rahmatullahi alayhi, commented on this verse saying, it's an obligation that when there is a command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and your inner self is commanding you something opposite, to shun that and obey him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When you hear an instruction, given by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and your wishes and desires are inclined elsewhere, it's mandatory upon you to adhere to his instructions. One of my shuyukh once saw me standing up when drinking. And drinking while standing up is a matter of difference of opinion amongst the scholars. It's a famous fiqhi matter. So I said, Sheikh, he said, sit down. I said, Sheikh, what is the predominant opinion? He didn't answer that. He said, imagine that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is standing in front of you and saying, Hazem, sit down when you drink. Will you ask him if this is only recommended or mandatory? Or will you sit down? Many of us shun the sunnah under the pretext is that it's only sunnah. It's only sunnah. But whose sunnah is it? It's the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's the practice of our Prophet and Messenger. Who will intercede for us? Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. Muhammad is a messenger before whom other messengers passed. So if he was to be killed or to die, will you turn back on your heels? And whoever turns back on his heels will not harm Allah at all. Brothers, a sign of our love to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that we adhere to his sunnah, follow into his footsteps in every little thing, in every little matter, before the major issues. اللهم إنا نسألك بأسمائك الحسنى وبصفاتك العلى ألا تحرمنا شفاعة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم شفعه فينا. اللهم أوردنا حوضه وأذقنا بيده الشريف شربة ماء لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا.